Look, most of us aren't usually quick on our feet. By that I mean, you know, you have a conversation with someone and then 3 days later you realise what you wish you should have said while you're driving the car and you, oh, could have won the argument. And look, who's had that experience? Yes, it's really like we all have. And we sort of kick ourselves for not having the right word at the right time. Well, the thing about Jesus, he always had the right word at the right time. He was wonderfully wise amongst everything else. And especially as he deals with those who come to trap him with a view of wanting to execute him. Now, you've got to understand the church of the time of Jesus hated him. The leaders of the church, I'm using kind of the word church in a particular way, but the church leaders at the time of Jesus hated him. He was a threat to them. And so they kept sending groups to him to try to trap him, to catch him out with a view of arresting him and having him executed by the Romans. But it would be a big mistake to think that all the different groups that hated him actually all thought the same thing. They didn't. So the group called the Pharisees, which were about 1% of the population, hated Jesus for different reasons to the Sadducees. And the Sadducees hated Jesus for different reasons to the Herodians. I mean, they couldn't stand each other, but on this they were united. They wanted him dead. And so they come, each with different attempts to trap him. And so this is not the first, I'm calling it the first trap, but really, if you were here last week, you would know that another group had tried to trap him with the words about who gave him the right to do what he was doing, the authority. But here we look at trap number one, and it's in verses 20 to 26. The teachers of the law and the chief priests were looking for a way to arrest Jesus, right? But they send their spies to do their dirty work, which is pretty much typical of their motives. In verse 20 we read, keeping a close watch on him, they sent spies who pretended to be sincere. They hoped to catch Jesus in something he said so that they might hand him over to the power and authority of the governor. So there they are, watching, pretending, spying, lying. They butted Jesus up by calling him teacher, which is anything is complete opposite to what they wanted. And they give him a personal character reference, which they didn't believe. Verse 21. So the spies question him, teacher, we know that you speak and teach what is right and that you do not show partiality, favoritism, but teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. Now, little do they know how absolutely spot on they were about Jesus. They just didn't believe what they were saying. But they were right on the money. He was the man of truth. He did speak that which is right. He did show no favoritism. If you like cricket, he plays a straight bat. He doesn't deviate. What he says to the prostitute, he'll say to the priest. But they set him up, and here's the trap. Verse 22. Is it right for us to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Remember, Israel was under Roman occupation. Caesar in Rome actually had the final authority over what took place there. It was a trap. It was a trap because if Jesus said, pay your taxes to Caesar, it would look like he's siding with the Romans against his own people and deemed to be disloyal. If he said, don't pay your taxes, he'd side with the people, but he'd be siding against Rome, and then they'd be dobbing him in quick as a flash and having him executed. So it's like heads I win, tails you lose. You're not going to win that one. But Jesus, of course, cannot be blindsided. Look what in verse 23a, it says he saw through their duplicity, their manipulation, their deceit. We saw this last week behind every question. Every question is a legitimate question. But behind every question is a heart, but not every heart is a good heart. It's either a heart wanting to search for the truth or a heart that's trying to keep the truth away. So I wonder right now, as we're hearing God's word read and proclaimed, examine your heart very quickly and think, what kind of a heart do I have? Am I a searcher of truth or am I committed to hiding the truth? Well, your response to Jesus will tell you what kind of a heart you have. Well, this is Jesus' answer. Verse 24. Show me a denarius, that's a coin. Whose image and inscription are on it? Caesar's, they replied. He said to them, then give back to Caesar what is Caesar and to God's what is God's. Now, here's a picture of a denarius. It has Tiberius Caesar on there, the emperor, a man who thought of himself to be God, a divine. You've got to understand, in the time of Jesus, Israel was like the airport. You know, you've got different currencies floating around. And so there was the Roman currency was really offensive to the Jews because they believed there was only one true God, and this clown is thinking he's a god and he's stamped on their currency. It's about the size of a 20-cent piece. But the fact that Jesus says, you know, bring me a denarius, they gave him one. The fact that they had one on them was themselves was already telling Jesus that they themselves did pay taxes, but that's another point. The word from Jesus is that is very profound. Give to Caesar what is Caesar's and to God's what is God's. Let's think about the first part of that. Jesus is introducing the idea of dual citizenship. That is, we are both at the same time citizens on earth as well as citizens of heaven. That to live under the rule and reign of Christ, it involves understanding the place of government within his purposes. The teaching of Jesus, that little sentence, give to Caesar what is Caesar, is the platform on which the foundation of governments in Western worlds operate. I don't know if you realize that. It's the reason why people want to move to Western countries, not move away. Christians are called to be good citizens. That to live under the rule and reign of God, this God, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, means that your attitude to government is one of positive. Even if they're a bad government, you still pay taxes. And remember, the Roman government was shocking. So we get to glorify God by paying our taxes. Think about that for a moment. When you go into your tax agent and this year, as you sit down and you start handing over all that information you've got and receipts, say, I'm here to worship my God. How much do I owe? And then can I minimize that if possible? Now, tax avoidance, that's wrong. Tax minimization, well, within the law, go for it. Now, I remember, it's funny, thinking of the church plant that we're sending, my mind has been taken back to other church plants. Our second one, the first one was MBM to begin with, which was a Bible study of six people in Blacktown. But the second one was in Fairfield, and I remember it was Dennis, a member who actually I think became a Christian through that church plant. He went from being a religious man to a born-again believer who understood grace. And I remember the day the penny dropped about paying taxes as one who lives under the Lordship of Christ. He owned a business in Fairfield. He was a hairdresser. He'd really, like a lot of small business owners, wasn't paying his taxes straight. And I understand there's a real pressure for small businesses, so I am sympathetic. But he wanted to live under the rule and reign of Christ, so he started paying taxes. Everything was above board. His personal income went from $1,000 a week, he said, to $400, just like that. Now, Dennis has gone to be with the Lord. He died, I think, last year. Now, can I say, do you think Dennis right now is regretting that decision? To give to Caesar what is Caesar's and to God's what is God's. No way. No way at all. But what do we mean give to God's what is God's? Now, in one sense, in the most narrow sense, can I say storing your treasures in heaven is a part of that one. You know, I want to say it's been really beautiful, by the way. The end of last year when people pledged, you know, there was an increase of pledges by 130 units of pledges. That's individuals or couples. So 130 more people pledged for this year than last year. And so it was like something like 334, I think, when there was like 202 the year before. And that was beautiful because more people were owning the vision, more people wanting to nurture their hearts and generosity. And it was because of that they were able to resource that new church plan. So I want to say thank God for you. But we're dealing more with just, you know, your giving versus your taxes to the government. If the coin represented the image of Tiberius Caesar, then you represent the image bearer of God himself. You are made in the image of God. You do not belong to yourself and neither do I. More than that, you are renewed in the image of Christ day by day. That we belong to another, one who created us, one who brought us back through his blood. And so there's a sense where I give to Caesar what is Caesar and I give to God what is God's. I give, it's not just my giving, it's actually my whole life that's involved. And that's why our vision, whether you're at MBM Rooty Hill or MBM Southwest Sydney, is exactly the same. We're committed to seeing lives transformed through Jesus Christ to the glory of God. Another way of saying we want people to live under the rule and reign and grace of our Lord Jesus. So I think of Dennis again. And I think of Dennis, whose life was transformed as a result of the ministry at the church. He went on to actually minister in another church, and he said everything he learned was from that church plant experience. It was really encouraging. But in his early days as a young Christian, he'd bought a BMW. Now, he always reckoned BMW stood for Big Money Waster. He thought PhD stands for Permanent Head Damage. He had some great one-liners. Anyway, so BMW, he bought a second-hand BMW, it cost him about $6,000. It was very second-hand. And he had fuel injection problem, couldn't solve it. He was planning through another $6,000 to get the sucker working. And his mates, his non-Christian mates, were saying, Dennis, let's do an insurance job. Let's take it out to a paddock, set it alight, insure it for $10,000, you'll get your money back. And the old Dennis said, I would have done it. But not the transformed Dennis. Not the one who met the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, I am so looking forward to continue to hear stories of lives, not only people becoming Christians, but people becoming more like Christ as a result of the church plant in Southwest Sydney. Well, the trap was set, Jesus responded, and he shut the lot of them up with his answer. Verse 26, they were unable to trap him in what they had said there in public, and astonished by his answer, they became silent. He did shut them up, didn't he? I just can't help but think that that's a little small picture of the day of judgment, when every mouth will be silenced and all our if onlys and if God was there, why doesn't he? And all our fist clenching, where every reason why any person decided not to believe in Jesus will completely dissolve into the fairy floss arguments that they are as we stand before the Lord Jesus, whose very scars remind us that forgiveness was possible to anyone who would come to him. Friends, it's possible to outsmart Christians. Easy peasy. I've been outsmarted many times. You just can't outsmart Christ. You can't outwit him. And so whether you're MBM Rooty Hill or MBM Southwest Sydney, can I just say what I said last week? Let's keep taking people to Jesus, revealed in the scriptures, in loving relationships. Because you and I, we're not clever enough to actually take on those questions. You and I aren't able to throw out the heart. Let Jesus do the hard work for us by letting him, as we journey with people in reading the scriptures. You know, I said last week, what are the 9 most important words that I pray will leave every one of our mouths in 2017? Here they are. Why don't we say it together? Would you like to read the Bible with me? There it is. Oh man, I'm telling you, MBM is built on that sentence. As people were introduced to Jesus for the first time, as we got out of his way and Jesus revealed himself from the Word, would you like to read the Bible with me? Well, I figured there's no point me telling you to do it if I'm not doing it. So yesterday I'm at the shops and I'm picking up a shirt that needed some work on it. And as I picked it up, and I've been in a conversation with it, like this didn't come out of the cold. I'd met him once before. We had some really good brief God conversations, but good conversations. So I thought, here we go. His name was Louis. Would you like to read the Bible with me? I said it a bit faster, but I'm expressing that I was very nervous. And he said, but I already read the Bible. I know what that means, you know, like once every 3 years. But I wasn't sure, so I said, Louis, can you just help me understand, if you were to die tonight and stand before Jesus, and he were to say, why should I let you into heaven? What would you say? And he said, well, I try to live a good life. And, you know, he's talking about all the things he had his faith in, and Jesus never came up once. And I said, why then do you think Jesus died on the cross? I said, it seems to me it would be a very good thing if we read the Bible together. And you may find that your answer is slightly different from the answer given in the Bible. Would you like to do that? And he said, okay. And so I don't know whether he's going to follow through. Now, what I'm going to do is what I'm going to ask you to do. You know those 5 questions in Bible study groups? That's the 5 questions. I'm going to stick with that. I'm not going to deviate from it. They're the 5 questions or a version of that. And I'm going to give it to him and we're going to read whatever passage in the gospel. We'll probably read what we're looking at church Sunday by Sunday and see where it goes. Now, Jesus does exactly the same thing with the Sadducees because they're about to come up and he says, would you like to read the Bible? Well, he doesn't say it that way, but he does go to the Bible to answer their question. Because trap number 2, the next mob that turns up are the Sadducees. Now, these had the highest authority, but they were the bottom of the run. These guys didn't believe in angels. They didn't believe in the resurrection. That's why they were sad, you see. It is a bad joke. Gets a mild laugh, and I still use it after all these years. The Sadducees, they also only believed in the first five books of the Bible. God has been speaking so much and they listened so little. They were atrocious. They believed when you're dead, you're dead. They're kind of like a modern person. They were wealthy, they were religious, they were materialists, and they believed when you're dead, you're dead. And they were not very nice people at all. Verse 27, some of the Sadducees who say there is no resurrection came to Jesus with a question. Oh, by the way, can I just say, I was talking to Alan Shepherd, a member of our church. He's 75 and does about 30 hours worth of work around. He said, but, you know, didn't Enoch walk with God and then was taken to heaven? I said, see, you know more than the Sadducees who studied all that. Anyway, what is surprising about the Sadducees, they really represented, these were the priests. We're not talking about some kind of pagan philosopher didn't believe in God. These believed in God. They just didn't believe there was a resurrection. So they came to trap Jesus in a funny sort of a way for us. Now remember, they only believed in the first five books of the Bible. And the fifth book of the Bible is Deuteronomy. And they quote Deuteronomy chapter 25 to Jesus. They talked about how a woman if she were to marry her husband and her husband died before bearing children, then her husband's next brother was obligated to marry her. The purpose of that was to guard his name, the first brother's who died's name, and to guard his inheritance allotted in the promised land. There was a purpose for it. I do want to say I'm very thankful to God that I live in the new covenant and that law doesn't apply to us. Because I like my sister-in-law, I just don't want to be married to her. Now, the Sadducees use that little piece of information and use it to kind of make fun of the idea of resurrection. So they set up what is really a silly situation where a woman marries seven times. She marries the first brother who dies without having children, then marries the next brother who dies without having children, the next, until she's actually married her way through the family. Six brothers she married, all dead. You can imagine the third or fourth marrying her. The wedding day must be such a scary event. But of course, it's a silly thing and it's not true. And then they think they're so smart. They say, okay, Jesus, given that little story, here's the question. Verse 33. Now then, at the resurrection, not that they believed in it, but at the resurrection, whose wife will she be since the seven were married to her? So it's not like you're going to have one woman with seven husbands. And they try making the idea of resurrection sound stupid, but really it's them who are sounding stupid. And Jesus, interestingly, he doesn't give one clever line here. What he does is start to teach them what they should have known. They were the priests. They had the covenant of Levi, which meant their job was to teach God's people. They didn't know 101. So he says, let's be clear. Number one, there is no marriage in heaven. You should have known that. You won't have to worry about which husband she's married to because there is no marriage in heaven. Verse 34. Jesus replied, the people of this age marry and are given in marriage. But those who are considered worthy of taking part in the age to come and in the resurrection from the dead will neither marry nor be given in marriage. So Ray and Sandy Galea won't be Mr. and Mrs. Galea in heaven. I'll be as close to you as I am to her in the new creation. Dan and Teresa Lee are not husband and wife in the new creation. They'll be brother and sister in Christ. Unlike Islam boys, there aren't only 72 virgins waiting for us. Unlike Mormonism, there is no celestial marriage that will go on into eternity where we'll procreate on other planets and other things that ought to be in science fiction rather than in theology. I don't know why they claim to read the Bible and hear Jesus say explicitly there is no marriage in heaven and they build a whole massive doctrine around it anyway. It's God's eternal plan. In God's eternal plan, marriage is for this age. It's temporary for as long as we both shall live and not beyond that. Which means a number of important things in all sorts of directions. For example, if you're in a bad marriage, relax, it's not forever. I know people who are comforted by that truth, so I thought I'd share it with you. Two, it's only another 40 years and then it's over. Resurrected bodies. Two, This should stop us from loving our spouses more than God, because marriage is appointed to the marriage is temporary. The real marriage that will go on into eternity is between Christ and his people. That's the forever marriage. That's where we truly say, and they live happily ever after. I remember a young woman who was part of our Bosley church plant that didn't work so well, but God still did good things in it. And I remember a young woman, she was a Christian, but she didn't know her Bible that well. And I still remember the day she came up to me and she said, "So there's no marriage in heaven." She was so disappointed. You can tell she wasn't married. She was so disappointed. No, because the reality of marriage means it can be hard work. I'm not putting marriage down. It's a great gift. She was so disappointed. And as she talked, I think I could see what she was thinking. She was picturing heaven like she was in a cinema where she was in the back seat with a husband, cuddling up, looking into each other's eyes for eternity while Jesus was up on the front somewhere. Little did she know that she won't be able to get her eyes off Jesus for all eternity. There is no marriage in heaven because there is no sex in heaven and there is no babies being born in heaven. The creation of new life happens in this order, not the left. The set number of humans to be born is in this age. And therefore, the place of marriage doesn't need to operate. And let's remind ourselves again, marriage is appointed to be the ultimate marriage between Christ and his people. The other application is this. It's clear that if you understand that maybe, just maybe, you won't be waiting decades for Miss or Mr. Perfect to come along, because Mr. or Miss Perfect doesn't exist. Jesus does. He's the perfect one, which means you approach the reality of marriage much more realistically. And I suspect if ever there was a generation that was waiting a long time for the perfect one to come, that one doesn't exist. He or she is a fallen image bearer, hopefully renewed in Christ, if you're following Jesus' plan to marry a believer, with lots of quirkiness. And I'm not saying, you know, drop your standards, but what I'm saying is don't have standards so high that in 20 years from now, the reason why you're single is because you let some really good people pass you by. I'll move on. It's a delicate one, that one. Number four, I tell you what is tragic. When, and I've had this happen a number of times where a person will say, you know, if Jesus is the only way and I know my dead husband or wife, therefore is probably not in heaven, well, I don't want to be in heaven either. Oh, that's God. What, you would prefer to share hell with someone who you're not going to even be married to rather than be in the presence of Jesus for all eternity? That is a tragedy. If that's you today, please don't do that. Please do not do that. And finally, if you're grieved at never having found the love of your life, and I know that's a grief, where the gift of marriage never seemed to come your way, and I know you long for it, and I think that's a legitimate grief, please remember the gift of marriage that you're missing out on is actually a very temporary gift. It's a limited gift. And the gift of singleness is also a gift too, but the most important thing to remember is you haven't missed out on the greatest gift of all, which is your relationship with Christ himself. Your lover, if you're a wife, that a woman, I think that speaks beautifully. He is your lover. If you're a man, he and a woman, he is your brother. He is your Lord. He is the one person who you can honestly say, he is enough. You haven't missed out on him. This teaching kind of gets everything back into perspective for us. So, no marriage in heaven. Secondly, there is a resurrection of God's people. And in this regard, and in only in this regard, we'll be like the angels. Verse 36. And they can no longer die. He's referring to those followers of Jesus Christ. For they can no longer die, for they are like the angels. They are God's children, since they are children of the resurrection. Isn't that beautiful? Not that they will, may not be able to die. They can no longer die. So you and I, we know that our days are numbered. There's a day coming when we will breathe our last breath. We live with the reality. We are enslaved to the fear of death. Although coming to Christ deals with that in a profound way. But we know this mortal body that we carry in this age will come to an end. We live ever conscious of that. especially we've had five members of our church losing a father, a spouse. It's been really brought to our attention. But when you get your resurrected bodies for a new creation, you will never be able to die. You'll be like the angels. There is no use-by date. There is no end. It is a forever. Isn't that extraordinary? What a kind God. But what would you expect? Would you expect anything less of a God who is full of mercy? That God's children are called children of the resurrection. Those who have risen from the dead. That's what Jesus defined himself, didn't he, in John 11. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. We may die physically, but we will never die. Death will have no hold over us. What a different world to the world of the Sadducees. When you're dead, you're dead. Luke 20, verse 37. Now Jesus says to them, would you like to read the Bible with me? Because he takes them to Exodus 3. The second book of the Bible, one of the books that they did believe in. The answer to their question was right under their nose. But in the account of the burning bush, even Moses showed that the dead rise. For he calls the Lord the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. He is not the God of the dead, but of the living. For to him all are alive. Some of the teachers of the law responded, well said, teacher. They weren't the Sadducees, you see. They didn't like the Sadducees. They believed in the resurrection. And no one dared to ask him any more questions. He shut them down again. How clever was that? I don't know if you appreciate it. Of all the debates the Sadducees had with other people, no one had taken them to Exodus 3. The fact that God had introduced himself to Moses, that I am the God of Abraham, the God of Jacob, and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob. The living God is the God of the living. It was right under their nose and they couldn't see it. That if the promises to Abraham, Isaac and Jacob were alive, well, so were they. Now remember, Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, if you don't know anything about the Bible, lived 2,000 years before Jesus. So they had physically died. But in God's eyes, they were alive. And when God introduced himself as the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, he never said, I was the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob. It's always, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I'm alive and they are alive to me, as are all of God's people who will be raised on the last day. Oh, these Sadducees, oh my goodness. Their whole lives were about believing in a God that either wouldn't or couldn't raise his own people from the dead. Let me tell you, that is one useless God, unfit for our worship. This is a God that produces a powerless religion. No wonder they were so godless. It all flows from it, you see. No. Our God sent his Son, who said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Friends, again, the impressive wisdom of Jesus, shutting them up. And you can bet your life they didn't like it. They'll come back fighting a few more days when it comes time to crying out, crucify him. Well, now Jesus, and let me just close very quickly with this. In verse 41, now Jesus, now the shoes on the other foot, where Jesus now asked them the question. In verse 41, Jesus says, then Jesus said to them, why is it said that the Messiah is the son of David? Now we're about to move. This now is quite complicated. And chances are you might even get it. And you're thinking, wow, what about if I'm reading this with someone who I say, would you like to read the Bible with me? And they say, I don't get this. I haven't got a clue. And they say to you, what does it mean? You know what you say? I don't know either. You've got to learn to say that. And stop being afraid of that response. But I will go and try to find an answer. And by the way, that'll make you a better Bible reader. Now, this Psalm 110 that's quoted by Jesus, is, by the way, the most quoted psalm. Might be the actually most quoted part of the Old Testament in the New Testament. And here is King David. Remember, King David lived 1,000 years before Christ. And he's speaking in a psalm, in a song of praise to God. And Jesus is picking up an observation here. And he says this in verse 42. David himself declares in the book of Psalms, the Lord God said to my Lord, that's the promised Messiah, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. David calls him Lord. How then can he be his son? So I know it's a little bit technical. Let me strip it back. God had promised King David, who lived 1,000 years before Jesus, that from his line will come a king who will head a kingdom that will never end. That's a little jab on the Sadducees who didn't believe in the resurrection. That God is promising a forever kingdom. And that king will come from the line of David. So here is David. He knows this promise. And he's actually in this prayer introducing us. Actually, he's introducing us to the Trinity. So in the prayer, he says, "The Lord God said to my Lord, the promised Messiah, to sit at my right hand until I make all your enemies at your foot, all your enemies placed at your feet." I told you it was complicated. Even I don't know what I'm talking about. And so he's picking up. Isn't it interesting that though David is his father, the Messiah's father, the Messiah is called Lord? It's like, why is that? It's like he's niggling them. And let me give you another silly example. I've got a friend of mine. He plays in a cricket team with his son. But his son is the captain of that team. So his son on the field is his boss. And so Jesus is saying, isn't that interesting how David calls the promised Messiah his Lord? And the bottom line is he's saying, because there's more to the Messiah than him being just another line in the King David. That he is going to be truly human, but you can get ready, he's going to be truly God as well. And as we will see, and as this psalm gets applied in the rest of the Bible, it's about the fact that Jesus, the true Son of God, Son of Man, God himself in the flesh, going to that cross, bearing for the sins of the world, then defeating sin and paying for sin, defeating death, being raised and installed at the right hand of the Father, disarming Satan, defeating death, paying for sins and ruling. And he's saying you can see the rule of Jesus already played out here, because as the groups come to Jesus, it's like they're being placed at his feet. These enemies are placed at his feet as he speaks to them, and they're completely humbled and silenced. It's a little picture of the day of judgment. Because let me tell you, friends, at the name of Jesus, every knee's going to bow, willingly or unwillingly, whether from the height of heaven or the pit of hell. And everyone's going to stand at his feet. You can either stand at his feet as an enemy or as one in worship, which is it to be. So the reason why we're sending a group to Southwest Sydney, and the reason why we're staying here for the western suburbs of Sydney, is for one reason: to declare this truth. At the name of Jesus, every knee's got to bow. Will you be placed at his feet from the vantage point of enemy or worshiper? Well, we beg you today, come and worship at the feet of this Jesus. Because come day of judgment, every mouth will be silenced. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for sending your Son, truly God, truly man, sin bearer, death defeater, installed at the right hand above all power and authority, enemies placed at his feet. Thank you that we get to be partnered with MBM Southwest Sydney as they declare there what we declare here, that Jesus is Lord, that at the name of Jesus every knee will bow. And Father, we pray that if there be anyone here today who has not yet come and sat at the feet of Jesus as a worshiper, oh, draw them this very moment that they may look up and kiss the feet of the King in humble obedience and trust. And Father, we so look forward to seeing the power of this message transform so many lives, both here and in Southwest Sydney. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.